KNON 89.3 FM in Dallas and Fort Worth, the voice of the people.
Business owners, tell KNON's listeners about your business. You can put your business or event on KNON. KNON currently has space available to run announcements for you. Tell KNON's listeners about your goods, services, nightclub, concert, or event. Help keep the voice of the people on the air while putting your information on the air. KNON's been named the number one radio station in Dallas by both the Dallas Observer and D Magazine. Put your business with Dallas's number one station. Call now for more information at 214-828-9500, extension 227, or extension 233. For more information, go to KNON.org and click on the Run Spots on KNON page. It's a great way for your business to support community radio while letting more people know about you.
And good afternoon and welcome to Lambda Weekly. I'm Dave Taffet, and I am here in the studio with Lerone Landis and the late Patti Fink. Josh is on the board. Doc is filming this for a podcast later. And our guests today are Carter Brown, Jade LaDuff, and Trey Pate. They are from Black Trans Advocacy, which includes Black Trans men and Black Trans women. You've grown since last year.
Yes, we have. Thank you for having us.
And you left Espy home.
Yes, I'm sorry Espy couldn't be with us today, but of course he sends her love.
We miss you, Espy.
We were hoping for an hour of nonsense, but we'll just have to get through with some good conversation. You have a conference coming up. Let's just give the information real quick. It's going to be at the Marriott?
Yes, this year we are at a new hotel. It's the Dallas Addison Marriott off of the Dallas North Tollway and Beltline Road.
And the dates?
The dates are April the 25th through May the 1st.
And if somebody wants more information on the conference, they can go to?
BTAC.blacktrans.org. And that's BTAC.blacktrans.org.
Okay. Or you can just Google Black Trans Conference. Advocacy. It'll come up.
Absolutely.
This is going way off topic, but we're going to go way off topic because we thought of it. You walked in and said, oh, yeah, we have to talk about that. Two new bills passed, one in Mississippi, one in North Carolina, that specifically target the trans community. Georgia vetoed theirs.
Yes.
Virginia vetoed theirs. Indiana has had theirs for a while. And
there's one cooking in Arizona.
Oh, there's like 17 of them cooking around the country.
Yeah, they've been brewing for a while there.
The only reason we don't have one in Texas is we have no legislature this year.
No, but it's marinating in Texas.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
It's coming.
We're planning. Here's what we've found in North Carolina. Lerone, you found the figures.
Well, so far, the 13 conventions have either pulled out or said that they're not going to even consider, whereas they were considering North Carolina. And just from those conventions alone and Bruce Springsteen pulling out his concert,
right.
The potential...
And PayPal.
And Red Ventures.
Red Ventures was bigger than PayPal.
Bigger than PayPal. They both have decided not to expand their companies, which would... PayPal would have created 400 jobs. The other one would have created 500 additional jobs.
But you know what else it creates? When you have a mass number of jobs like that created, generally for every one job that a company creates, two other jobs are created, usually in the service industry because there are restaurants and gas stations and retail stores and just all kinds of other stuff that pops up around those jobs. So of the 900 jobs that we know of that have been canceled, that's a loss of another 1,800 jobs in development.
So you add all of that together, to the potential that North Carolina is about to lose is $6.3 billion.
Wow.
With a B.
That's so far.
That's so far.
Mm-hmm.
That's so far.
Do you know the other one? Stephen Schwartz, who wrote Wicked and Pippin, he has refused to license any of his shows for production in North Carolina.
And so has Lionsgate. They were going to have some films... scheduled to film there, they have pulled out also.
And that was a big deal happening in the Georgia bill, which the governor ultimately vetoed very smartly, because The Walking Dead is filmed in Georgia.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah,
oh,
he was going to, they were going to pull all of that.
And here's what's so
bad.
They would have walked.
And that show would have been dead.
But here's what is really bad. Not only did, you know, Lionsgate pull out, they've already rescheduled somewhere else, not in America, Canada.
In Vancouver.
And Canada. Okay, so we're losing money to another country.
You know, we've lost all these jobs now, or maybe we'll gain them. PayPal might come here because Texas is so open to our trans community. Okay, so Carter, we've heard this from other people and we've asked them. This all comes down to where you pee.
Pretty much. Or
why do you people insist on peeing?
The nerve of us doing human things.
Right.
But I think this all boils down to the fact that America is ready for change, and that, you know, we are seeing that people are equal. So this discrimination against transgender people, a very, very small population of people of the overall American society, and their discrimination against this small group of people has caused this mass effect that doesn't only affect transgender people, but our friends, our families, our employers, our health providers.
Now, legally in North Carolina, now describe Carter. Just describe him, Patty.
Facially.
Very, very masculine.
Well, he has a beard, a mustache.
It's a beard. He's got bald head. he's got muscles.
He does have muscles. I gave him a hug. I was like, dang.
Okay, well, let's let Lerone talk a little more. Now.
Okay, so Carter, in North Carolina and in Mississippi, the law says you have to pee in a ladies' room.
Yeah.
How stupid is that?
Very, very. I mean, that's an uncomfortable situation for anyone, you know. And, of course, any lady wouldn't want to share a bathroom with me, nor would I want to share one with them. When overall, male or female, the ultimate goal is to go into the bathroom, relieve yourself, and leave out. So I don't see that.
Do you know every other transgender person who's been on this show has said the same thing, that all they do is go into the bathroom, they pee, and they leave?
Well, I go in the mirror. A little bit.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm sorry. Yes, you're right. That
and let's
is,
hope everybody washes their hands right.
Jay,
right,
that right, is right, the right, other right. thing, because Leslie, when she comes on, she says she brushes her hair a little
absolutely,
bit.
Absolutely. But at the end of the day, it's not
you
like,
brush your hair in the bathroom.
Who would have thunk?
You know, these things that you people are doing, and I like to call them you people because, you know, here's what I want to know. Have you heard any rumors of a plan P in? Because I would love to go. And let them start figuring out which ones of us are male and which ones are female and which ones are biologically whatever and whose birth certificate says what. Seems right. like an awful lot of government money is going to be spent on this.
Absolutely.
You know, all joking aside, do you all have any experiences to share personally or someone else that you know who's trans, who has any incidents just by going to the restroom, a public restroom?
I would probably say it really depends on, and I'm going to use this term very loosely, but it depends on their unfortunate appearance. If they appear to be more male or more female, then they probably wouldn't have as much of an issue. Now, I have heard of people having issues when they're going into the restroom. You know, it's more of a, you know, look that you get more so than, you know, any actual physical harm, knock on wood, thank goodness.
Right.
But
I mean, like somebody dialing 911 or...
No,
or just somebody even saying something to you.
I mean, you know. You know if someone is looking at you with disdain or something.
Right.
You know, what are you doing in here?
It's been perfected in the South.
Don't worry, it's only Carter that we're looking at with disdain today.
But yeah, so I think it really just depends on that aspect of it.
Right.
See, and that's what we needed ESPY for. ESPY's the perfect one for us to have looked at with disdain. Tell her that. I mean, this is so stupid, especially trans men. Most of them that I've seen have a beard.
I mean, some facial hair, yeah.
Or some facial hair. Women don't want you in their room, in their restroom, I would think.
I completely understand.
You know what I don't get is I think a lot of people who are most vocal and outspoken about not wanting any trans person to be in the restroom with them have probably been to the restroom and a trans person's been in there with them and done their business and left all over this country. You know, mm-hmm. they've probably been to the restroom already with mm-hmm. a lot of trans people.
Absolutely.
And left the restroom without incident.
Absolutely.
Right.
Right.
And right. they had no, they were not nervous. They were not, you know, they had no disdain. They weren't feeling that. None of that was happening right. because they didn't even know.
Or yep. or probably so, you know, even more so, maybe many haven't and just assume the worst because of the images that the media show us of, you know, a perceived man in a dress going into the bathroom with a small girl. Then, of course, we would see that as something more threatening than the actual experience of just being in the restroom with someone that looks a little different.
Now, we know they certainly have been in a restroom with a masculine appearing lesbian.
Yes.
With a masculine appearing straight woman. I mean, every woman is not the most feminine. Look at Patti. She's the least feminine person in this room right now.
That could be. That could be.
You're welcome. But
Patti
and then men, not every man is the most masculine man.
Right.
Look
at
Lerone.
I'm looking at David.
I knew that was coming.
How are they going to put, you know it's, there's no, not even a point in actually talking about this because right. it's so stupid.
Right.
It really is.
Okay, so Mississippi, just quickly, capped their week of stupidity with an even stupider law. Their stupider law now allows churches to designate somebody as the person who will have a firearm. Okay, so you want the church protected. I don't know about you, but when we've needed at ours, we've hired police. But okay, so you can designate somebody to carry a firearm and use it in your church. If you happen to kill somebody by mistake, you won't be prosecuted under this law. And the other part of this law says that this law and the Mississippi Constitution override the U.S. Constitution and any Supreme Court rulings.
Oh, they've tried that. They tried that in Texas. They tried to say, thankfully these laws never even got past committee. But they've tried to say, and no one can rule this law unconstitutional. No one. That's
okay, so
all of these laws in North Carolina and in Mississippi that have just been passed, and this latest one with the church gun. They're all patently unconstitutional.
Yeah,
they will lose.
They will lose.
Is this
unconstitutional stuff?
Does this apply to every church in Mississippi? Or
it didn't specifically leave out black churches, but I'm surprised.
I mean, they would probably be surprised if the black churches were armed and ready because those are usually the ones that are targets of attacks.
Absolutely. Oh, no. No. It's white Christians.
Yeah, I'm sure.
They're being persecuted.
Well, let's go back to North Carolina.
I just one more thing about that. So not everybody who is in office in that state is a complete idiot. A senator from Jackson stood up, looked at the bill's author, and said, "Where the hell did you go to law school?"
Right.
So, well, let's go back to North Carolina. Two more things I want to mention. You know, we did mention that Bruce Springsteen pulled out his concert and issued a very long statement. Can't praise him enough for doing that. Also, Charles Barkley. Everybody knows who Charles Barkley is. He's very opinionated. Love him to death. He is urging the NBA to pull out the NBA All-Star team in 2017. That is huge if
Indeed.
They do it. I mean, that's probably huger than most of the stuff that's already pulled out so far. That's a week-long event with millions of dollars pumped into the city. Mm-hmm. And then this one really makes my heart smile. The NAACP... they are organizing a sit-in until the law is repealed. You know, it just makes me feel good when different groups can get together and protect one another, even when it's not really their interest.
So
thank you, NAACP. I love to hear that.
Absolutely.
What's the most shocking to me about the Mississippi bill is that it's so, the governor was like talking in a twisted mouth or something because he was saying this is so targeted. That it protects specific, you know, protects everybody and protects people living their lives. I'm thinking, not if you're gay, you know, not if you're trans, but
because the law is specific that you can discriminate against gay people can't discriminate against straight people under this law.
Oh, yeah, exactly. So if you, the law in Mississippi basically says if you disagree with same-sex marriage, you can deny services to gay people and gay couples, openly, proudly, whatever. And when they pass these bills, as they did with Indiana, last year. I really think they ought to have, if that's the way they believe, they ought to have the balls to put a sign in the window that says no gays allowed, no trans allowed. They ought to have the balls to own it. And, you know, not so that you find out, not so that you think you're going into a normal public business. Because if you hang your shingle out to serve the public, you serve the public.
Right.
Right.
But that's what killed it in Oklahoma.
There was a rider on their bill, and within 30 minutes, the bill was dead.
But, you know, to put the sign out.
But also, yeah, let's point out that what you just said, Patti. That's what defines the Mississippi bill. The North Carolina bill goes even further. It's not just if you disagree with gay marriage. You can discriminate against anybody who's gay. Mm-hmm. For any public accommodation,
you don't even need a religious belief.
You don't. I mean, that's why everyone is going crazy about the North Carolina bill.
And where was it, Mississippi or North Carolina, that somebody wouldn't allow a black and white couple to
interracial couple was thrown out of a point.
Was that Mississippi because it was against their religious beliefs?
Yes. Yes.
So,
well, he was really concerned about what the neighbors would think. That's what he said. Let's
get back to our guests, Carter. Let's just talk a little bit about your organization. You created Black Trans Men originally, which now has an offshoot group, Black Trans Women.
Yes.
Specifically because there are issues that affect the trans community, but affect you because you're black as well.
Yes.
What are those? I mean, some of them are obvious, but what are some of those issues?
Well, there are several issues that are unique to the black trans community at the intersections of race and then gender identity within the black community. I mean, of course, we're still black, so we're dealing with all of those issues that you can assume or may even know of personally. But also, as transgender people, it's hard for us to find community even within the black community. So we have to pretty much build our own community. And a challenge for us is learning to empower ourselves and have self-love for ourselves, because not only are we finding the challenges of our journey in transition, but then also finding others who are who share that unique journey is something that's hard to do.
Do you have special problems because of the church? Because the church is so important to so many black families.
Yes, absolutely. The church is a very prominent guide to a lot of black families. And we see all the time gay people that are ostracized from the churches. But then it's also a little easier for a gay person to pretty much suppress or not be as visibly or openly gay and still be a part of the church. However, as a transgender person, often your identity is known and you are ostracized from the church. And you also have the influence, the church influence, that's telling you that your lifestyle is wrong or that who you are overall is wrong, not so much a lifestyle. So that's really a big conflict for trans people. And then also the violence against black trans people is something that we have to deal with as a major disparity of our specific community.
Yeah, I've lost count. Well, you know, we need to take a break.
Yeah, I think you were going to say it was 28 black trans, mostly women, who were killed in the United States last year.
Yes.
Yeah. Terrible statistic. Anyway, we'll be back. Our guests are Carter Brown, Jade LaDuff, and Trey Pate. They're from Black Trans Advocacy. I'm Dave Taffet here in the studio with Lerone Landis and the late Patti Fink, and we'll be back right after this.
Kimberly Truax of the GLBT Wedding Expo, and you're listening to Lambda Weekly on 89.3 KNON FM.
Welcome back to Lambda Weekly. I'm Dave Taffet here in the studio with Lerone Landis and the late Patti Fink. Our guests are from Black Trans Advocacy, Carter Brown, Jade LaDuff, and Trey Pate. Lerone, you were in the middle of saying...
Just before the break, we were talking about the alarming statistic of, you know, the trans murders that happened last year, most of which happened to be black trans victims. I was just wondering, did any of y'all can speak on this, if you like. Do you have a theory as to why? Why there's so huge imbalance?
Would you like to chime in?
So, first of all, just the whole challenge as a trans woman is just living your life. And at the end of the day, no one's trying to fool anyone. But in those, I don't know specifically about each situation. However, it just really depends on the environment in which the person was at the time that these things occurred. I'm not condoning in any way, shape, or form violence against anyone. But for myself, I have to be very strategic in where I place myself. You know, will I go somewhere alone at nighttime, unfamiliar territory, and walk down the street and I get lost? You know, am I subjecting myself to potential violence? So with that being said, it just, do I think about it? Of course, on a daily basis, unfortunately, because you just never know what might be a trigger for someone when they find out. So yeah, that's my take on it. And unfortunately it does happen, and it's more frequently than I would like to say.
And it's unfortunate that it's become, I think, accepted, not I think, it has become accepted among, I don't generalize, but you know, heterosexual men, that if they they are in relations with someone who is transgender and find out what their, you know, their birth gender is, it's okay to inflict physical harm on them.
Absolutely.
I mean, I've heard people just say, well, yeah, you should kick it, you know. And I'm like, that's not okay.
Well, and that's the big fear about some of these laws. If they say, wow, the government just told me I have a license to discriminate against these people, there must be lesser than. You know, obviously, the law, the government, not just society, the government thinks they're less than enough to say that, hey, you go ahead and discriminate against them. It's okay with us. There's no penalty for it whatsoever. You just do it. You feel like it, you do it. That's going to lead to enormous increases in violence, because if they think, if they have that mindset and the government has given their stamp of approval on it, why not? You know, if they feel a violent urge, let's just go through with it. You know, because if we were, white, straight males, you would never dream of, oh, I have, the state says it's okay, I can you know, I can murder this person and no one will care. Because it's, you know, white, straight males make the rules. And anybody less than that, and they have just pushed all of us, especially trans people of color, right down, you know, to say it's okay. And I just, that's so repulsive to me. I can't, this North Carolina, this Mississippi, and what every legislature seems to be thinking about that's controlled by Republicans, including Texas. You know, what is this country coming to?
I know.
I've never seen or heard of anything like this in since Jim Crow.
I keep asking myself,
where the government sanctions discrimination.
Is this 2016 or 1916?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Or 1816.
Or 1816.
Yeah, and you're absolutely right, Patti. I think that a large part of the reason that the trans murders continue is because we don't see the consequence of the perpetrators of these crimes. We don't see that there's any repercussions for hate-inflicted crimes. You know, if there's police brutality against a young black male, you know, we see the world, we've seen the world come together and say, hey, we got to stop this crimes against humanity, you know. And you know, we say that there's over 20, 30 black trans women murdered each year. The numbers continue to go up. But do the numbers continue to, are the numbers being reported in the mass media? Not at all. There's no urgency about the lives of people that are a part of the trans community. You know, if these were young white teens that were being murdered at this rate, surely something would be done. We've seen it here in Dallas. There were just attacks, not to minimize the actions, but there were attacks on a lot of gay men in the Oakland area, and quickly the police got involved, the community got involved, and we made sure that they again felt safe and that people knew that these are people and their lives are valuable. But there's no urgency when it comes to black trans lives, other than it seems within our own community and with those that are stand with us as allies. But we need greater society to see the value of trans lives as well.
Yeah, unfortunately, one of those murders, Ms. Shade, a woman of color, was murdered here in Dallas. Not a single clue in that murder. And it's not for the police not trying, because, boy, was the gay community, the trans community, boy, were we after the police to work on that one. And they did. Not a clue. It's very frustrating. But let's just talk a little bit about your group. Your group started 5 years ago. You put on a conference.
Yes.
You just decided, let's do a Black Trans Men conference.
Why not?
And, because, you know, why not? There was no reason why not. Nobody else was doing it.
Right.
And you became, from that, a national organization.
Yes, we started in 2011 as just an online group, and just building community with other Black trans people and seeing the commonalities that we had and the disparities that were faced, and then also just the hunger to have that support of each other and that familiarity and that family orientation with each other prompted us to have our to celebrate our first year with our conference, which is in 2012.
So you, at the end of your first year, you had mm-hmm. your conference, and people came from all over the country.
Yes, yes.
Because nothing like this was being done anywhere
right.
else. Now, does this surprise you, Patti?
That it started here in Dallas?
Yeah.
No, not at all.
Not at all. That's what we do best. the LGBT community.
We start things that haven't been done before.
If there's a group to be created, it's created here. So you started Black Trans Men. Now there's Black Trans Women.
Yes.
It started just you and Espy. Now you have other staff
yes.
and volunteers. Jade, tell us a little bit about what you're doing.
So I met Carter probably the end of 2015, beginning of 2016?
Yes.
Okay. So around that time, and I was reaching out for resources and immediately after the first time meeting with him and seeing this organization and not knowing of it prior to meeting him, I'm just doing my own little research and Googling and all that kind of stuff. I was just blown away. I was like, oh my gosh, I have to be a part of this. And more just investing a lot more of my time with the organization and just doing whatever I can to be a voice of advocacy, be a an educating voice, just to show people who want to know.
You know, and obviously you're on the show here with us today, mm-hmm. but where are you doing, who are you reaching out to?
I would say to other women, trans women. I say all the time, women of trans experience, just as a blanketed statement. Mm-hmm. But anyone who wants to be educated on what trans is. Now, mind you, it does not necessarily make me any different of a person per se. It's just a part of who I am. And that's one thing that's been a...
Okay, now we've done lots of shows with lots of trans guests. Mm-hmm. But one of the things he said is, you explain what trans is. I'm sure we have some listeners today who don't quite understand it.
Okay.
So what is trans?
So I'm not going to use the example that is from, you know, Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, because mm-hmm. that's probably...
not a
love that movie, though.
It's a great movie. Must watch. But I would say my definition is as a transgendered woman, being that I was not biologically born a woman. However, everything about me, is that of a woman. Mm-hmm. And I've known...
When did you first know? Yeah.
Oh, I've known since preschool, mm-hmm. But I did not live in an environment that cultivated me living as my correct gender. However, they let me be who I was, per se, but not as a different gender.
Mm-hmm. So you did, like, what?
I didn't do anything associated with being a boy or a male.
So you didn't do sports?
Absolutely not.
Okay. Okay, so this might surprise you. I didn't either.
Wow.
But I never identified as transgender in any way.
Yeah.
Did you do things like baking?
So I'll give you...
Go right for the stereotype.
No, because I was going to say I did that.
Well, this is the thing. So I did not grow up with a sister in my home. Mm-hmm. I had an older brother, but we weren't very, you know, mm-hmm. together or you know, buddy-buddy. But for one of my birthdays, I really, really wanted the Dirt Devil vacuum dealy, and I wanted the, it wasn't an Easy Bake Oven, but it was like a kitchen set, mm-hmm. and it had like the frying pan and the oven, and it was this huge thing, and I told my parents, I'm like, this is what I want, and they got it. But even
good for them.
Well, good for them. However, Okay. Fast forward, you're like, okay, but wait, when I was small, you did this. But it's, they allowed me to be who I was, and they didn't force me into any specific concrete shape.
And there had to be something in addition, because my point on that was, I used to bake with my mother, and then I baked with one of my other friends who came out about the time I did in college. We'd just go into the kitchen and we'd make cookies. Mm-hmm. Who knew we were gay? But we never identified as transgender. Yeah, so what's the additional part?
The biggest thing is wondering why that's there. That's the best way of putting it. I've always, as a child, I was confused as to why is this here on me, mm-hmm. but it's not there on them. And to the point where I pretended like it really wasn't there. Mm-hmm. And then I was convinced that when I was born, you know, my parents sewed it up. And I just, you know, how dare them choose what I wanted to be? You know, I just.
But they didn't sew it up, did
Absolutely.
They?
Absolutely.
Okay.
So,
well,
you really have known.
They didn't. A very long
okay,
time.
Okay, so the difference is, while I did some stereotypical things for a gay kid, you did those stereotypical things that a girl would do. Mm-hmm. I always knew I was a boy. You always knew you were a girl.
Absolutely.
And in a way, it's kind of that simple. Would you agree, Trey?
I do. That's kind of a big question.
Uh-huh. I know it is. I know.
I definitely do agree. Like for me, growing up, it was the complete opposite. Like I was always, you know, a tomboy. I did, you know, a lot of the boyish things, but at the time I didn't know what trans was, so I just thought that I was gay. Like I just thought that made me a lesbian. And then when I got a little bit older, I realized the difference between being trans and being a lesbian is the fact that lesbians enjoy being lesbians. They enjoy being women who love other women, and I didn't, you know, I didn't see myself as a woman at all. And so that's, I don't know, I started doing a little bit of research and I found the difference between that. Mm-hmm. But I don't know, I feel like I'm at a loss right now.
Well, either one of you, how did your parents or how did your families react?
My parents ignored it. They wanted me to be a girl so bad that they eventually gave in. Probably when I was around middle school, they let me, I still had to wear girl clothes, but they were at least more androgynous, you know. Mm-hmm. I was allowed to wear like boy cut underwear, but still for, you know, girls. But they tried their hardest to just ignore that wasn't really happening. They wanted me to be mm-hmm. their little girl so bad, and I just couldn't do it. And
it's the la 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 la.
Yeah, like if you act like it doesn't happen, it's not going on type thing. That's.
And Jade, your parents were delighted.
surprisingly, when I told my mother, I never cried harder in my life after I told my mother, because she was so accepting.
Really?
She was just, Bravo. It blew my mind. And I text Carter and I was like, oh my, because I didn't transition until I became an adult. I'm more of an adult. But she was so accepting and just like, she's like, you're my child, I love you, I just want you to be happy. And it just blew my mind. It completely blew my mind. My father cries all the time because he understands it and he loves me regardless. And he says this all the time. However, his actions are a lot different than his words.
Mm-hmm. He's trying and though. Clearly he's trying.
He is trying, and I give him that. And I have a beautiful family that's very supportive. And I have a beautiful family here that's very supportive. So yeah, I would say that thankfully, and it's not very common in the African-American community, mm-hmm. my parents were very understanding and accepting of
that's
the
transition. That's wonderful.
Bravo, Jade's, wonderful. Jade's parents
absolutely.
Rock.
Yes.
But I have a feeling that in white families, they're not quite all that accepting about it.
Yeah,
either.
I mean, it's
yeah.
just, but as we mentioned, it's wonderful. Bizarre, you know, some of the situations that I've heard.
Trey, do you think it would have been easier for your parents to digest if you had just said, I'm a lesbian?
Actually, in a way, yes, because I didn't have that conversation with them until I actually started taking hormones to be you know, in transition. And at that point, they were like, well, why can't you just be a lesbian?
So, yeah. I think I kind of paid you.
I think yeah. Chaz Bono had the best answer. Now, Chaz's mother is Cher. Yeah. And Chaz said, yeah, when I came out to my mother as lesbian, she didn't talk to me for a week. When I came out to her as transgender, she didn't talk to me for a year. And that was the difference. And that's Cher.
And she doesn't believe in love, apparently.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Uh-huh. So, we're going
to
talk...
I'd like to turn back time, maybe, too.
Right. and they're on great terms now.
Yeah.
I mean, it took a while. Is that what you generally find with a lot of people that... Some families, it just takes them time.
Time, yeah.
Yeah.
I would say in most cases it does take time. That could be anywhere from a few months to a few years. It could go from extremities of, you know, the parent just had a hard time accepting it and came back the next day to work on it, or till they cut them off for years. And unfortunately, we see far too often that it's just really hard to get that familiar, or for people to deal with not having that familiar support, that it affects them to a deep depression, and they often take their lives as well, as transgender people trying to adapt without acceptance.
And that's why I think groups like yours are so important, because if we remember that from the time we knew we were LGBT until we came out,
mm-hmm.
and particularly until we came out to our family,
mm-hmm.
That's a period of time that it took for us to adjust and mm-hmm. to gain knowledge and to gain understanding mm-hmm. and to feel and tap our own compassion for ourselves. And our parents and our families need that time too.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
when we have expectations that they'll just, you know, be immediately accepting, that's not really fair. They may need some time. Yeah. They may need a lot of time. And so you have a support group
mm-hmm.
that can be there for a person while their family is coming
right.
around,
absolutely.
while their family's taking that needed time
mm-hmm.
to get to that place, that
absolutely.
They can be fully supportive and embrace you as their child, and you know, I think that's important.
It really is, because we all went through that.
Mm-hmm. We all do.
We need to take a break. You're listening to Lambda Weekly on 89.3 KNON FM. I'm Dave Taffet here in the studio with Lerone Landis and the late Patti Fink, and we'll be back with more right after this.
Hi, this is Patti Fink, and you're listening to Lambda Weekly on 89.3 KNON FM.
And welcome back to Lambda Weekly. I'm Dave Taffet here in the studio with Lerone and Patti, and our guests are from Black Trans Advocacy, Carter Brown, who founded the group, Jade LaDuff and Trey Pate, who are part of the recent explosive expansion of your group. Lerone, we were talking before the show a little bit about parenting.
I wanted to lead into this saying, you know, one of the things that's so upsetting about these so-called bathroom bills is that they say that they're in for the protection of kids.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's just really hurtful to LGBT parents ourselves. We're parents too.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
it's like, you know, we don't harm our kids. You know, if I have to say so, I'll give my own self a pat on the back.
Mm-hmm.
We do some of the best parenting out there.
Mm-hmm. Your kid harms you, Lerone.
You know, we're not out to target and harm any children.
Right.
But so, you know, I just wanted to get that out of the way. But also, you know, Carter is a dad also.
Yes.
A very cute little girl, same age as mine. I know you haven't gotten to that point yet, but do you plan on and should trans parents even have that conversation with their children about maybe what their original anatomy was?
Well, first I'd like to say hello to my baby girl. Hey, Jayla.
So she's listening.
We miss you. Wish you were here today.
She's listening then.
Yes, I'm sure she is. I'm sure she is. But I won't say that it's a conversation that each trans parent should have. I think it solely depends on the person and their family structure and the relationships dynamics of their specific family. However, for me personally, I do feel it's important for my daughter to know my trans identity, not so much my anatomy
right.
and so forth. I don't think that an adult and child should be having discussions about anatomy other than teaching the child about their anatomy.
Absolutely agree.
Okay, so Carter, from before the show, I thought you hadn't had this discussion yet at all.
No, we have not had this discussion.
Okay, well, now you're going to, since she's listening today.
Well, I can say this. My daughter, she's very sharp, she's very intelligent, and she's my number one supporter. She knows all about Black Trans Men. She's been to every conference.
Oh,
she loves
good.
Everyone. So she definitely has had exposure to the transgender community, LGBT community, and she knows that daddy works for Black Trans Men. Now, if she has a complete understanding of what trans identity is, no, we have not sat down and talked about that conversation. However, we do have very progressive and open conversations with her about gender expression and gender identity and how that can be unique and open for anyone.
Okay, so here was a problem Lerone ran into. It wasn't really a problem, but a concern he had when Gabrielle first went to school.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to make sure that the principal and the teachers and everybody who was going to be touching that kid knew exactly what kind of family she came from, mm-hmm. and did they have a problem with it, and if they did, he wanted nothing to do with them.
Mm-hmm.
And he found a wonderful school, wonderful pediatrician, wonderful, you know, all very accepting.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with you with school?
No, I have not informed her school
of
you know, the dynamics of myself or my family or anything,
because you appear to be a heterosexual family.
That's what I'll say, that by default, I mean, we're a heterosexual family. You know, I don't, only within my work and in forums where it's needed do I announce my transgender identity and implement activism and so forth. But just by default, you know, if I'm at Walmart with my daughter or we go out to the movies or dinner as a family, that's how we appear and that's what we are. So know that I try to, now that my daughter's getting older and she's getting more of her own social life, I try to be conscious of how my life, my visible life, intersects with hers. So, no, I have not informed the school or anything.
And I guess different trans families, based on the configuration of the family and who the people mm-hmm. Are going to have different concerns.
Maybe. Well, and I think it goes back to what she was saying. You know, unfortunately, a lot of it goes on appearance. You may not need to say anything.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, on a daily basis, I work, you know, with the public.
Mm-hmm.
So on a daily basis, I may come into contact with 2,000 or more people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's never a question, you know, hey, what's going on mm-hmm. down there? It's not that, you know, for me, mm-hmm. for
right,
me.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. I can't say the same for other people.
Mm-hmm.
But it definitely, it makes it a little easier.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'm very thankful. Thanks, Mom and Dad.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Because it's been easier for me. But.
Right.
I agree.
Now, let's go into a little bit about the conference. Your conference is the 5th annual Black Trans Advocacy Conference. It's going to be at the Marriott on April
25th through May the 1st.
Okay, and you can find it online. Just Google it. One of the seminars that you're doing is on sexuality and fluidity in the mm-hmm. trans community. What do you mean by that?
Well, I'm going to let Trey elaborate a little bit on that, but that's as far as the trans men community, that's one of the prominent conversations that we are consciously having. Going back to our conversation where we were talking about gender expression as a child, the other end of that is that we have trans individuals such as trans men who identify with a lot of feminine characteristics or what society would define as feminine characteristics, even in their daily life, or to wanting to bear their own child. And these are complex issues for us as a trans community that we are aiming to talk about. And so Trey's going to be conducting his very first workshop about that. And it's pretty much just going to be an open discussion, trans men exclusive, where they're talking about that. Trey,
okay,
you want to
so,
give him a little?
Trey, tell us a little bit about that. I think that's interesting.
Yeah, basically, one of the things that I notice with a lot of the guys when we transition, there's like this sense of hyper masculinity where they feel like in order to be a man, I need to do this or I need to do that. And so as trans,
like, you need to have a beard and be bald.
Exactly. And muscles.
And have muscles.
Gotta have the muscles.
For a lot of people, a lot of trans men specifically, there's a lot of confusion and emotions behind having sex in the way we have sex, or the way that we potentially can have sex because of our different anatomy. And you know, people, I know people sometimes feel like it makes them less of a man because they can have sex in a certain kind of way, or some people just, you know, no, I'm not going to do that because I need to be doing, you know what I mean? So it's just overall an open discussion to let people know, hey, this is your body, take care of it, do what you got to do for you, however that looks, you know, it's normal, it's healthy, it's okay. So that's basically what that is.
Another one of your topics that you're dealing with is accepting ourselves.
Yes, another one is accepting ourselves, and also how that ties into our spirituality. And actually, Jade is going to be doing a workshop on spirituality and just learning to accept ourselves in a spiritual, through a spiritual lens versus the influences of religion. Jade, did you want to chime in?
Jade, yeah.
So for me, I identify myself as a very spiritual person, mm-hmm. Though I do attend a specific church and I am a member at that church. I find that my spiritual awareness is something that I was born with. Mm-hmm. So everything that is me, everything about me, is very that of love. So the thing that the title of my workshop is Shining the Light of Spirituality with Love. So it's just basically, if you love yourself or you express yourself in a, you know, bubble of love at all times, mm-hmm. That really doesn't necessarily make you any less religious. I don't know if I'm making sense. Let me back
up. No, I agree with that because... Yeah, now, I'm Jewish.
Okay.
We're Reform. And the Orthodox would say, oh, you're much less religious. And I disagree with that.
Mm-hmm.
We just practice our religion differently.
Absolutely.
And our services, we can fit it into an hour and a half. Theirs are 4 hours long. I don't need to do that.
Yeah.
It doesn't make me feel any less religious.
Absolutely.
But I do think there's a big difference between spirituality right. and religion.
Absolutely. Uh-huh. They can exist separately. And they can also exist together.
Mm-hmm.
So, like I said, I consider myself very spiritual, and you know, knowing that there is some higher power out there that has created all of us in these beautiful images is something that I think needs to be acknowledged in some way, shape, or form, regardless of your religion. But it doesn't make you any less of a person because you're Jewish. It doesn't make me any less of a person that I'm not. But it's all about embracing everyone's love, and it's all about just embracing everyone's journey wherever they are on their spiritual mm-hmm. journey.
Has the trans community, and Carter, this is probably for you, have you found that the trans community has gotten some stuff from the LGB community about accepting ourselves? Because suicide, all that kind of mm-hmm, stuff was mm-hmm. a rampant problem mm-hmm. in the gay and lesbian community for years.
And continues to be.
And continues to be.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like epidemic in the trans community.
Mm-hmm.
What's the statistic? Is it something like 40% of trans people have attempted suicide, something like that? Or is it more?
It's about 60% in the black trans community, yes.
Okay.
Wow.
Are there differences between the trans community in acceptance and the LGB community in acceptance?
I'm not. Are you? Is your question as far
I'm
as
not
the
sure
LGBT?
What my question is. Just answer whichever one you got.
Well, I'll say that there's a huge similarity in the movement for LG mm-hmm. rights, and the B. I feel just kind of. Is blended in there somewhere. And then there's a very big similarity between the movement for LG rights and then the trans movement in that, you know, we're the new gay in a lot of ways. Of course, trans people aren't anything new, but we're just now gaining...
See, that's what I was asking.
But we're just now gaining more visibility, and with more visibility, more people are able to step out more. Just as we saw, you know, once more gay people came forward, more people were coming out, and more people would stand together to make, you know, political moves so that there could be more equality and so forth. And so we have the same thing being replicated for the trans community. And I think what is really great is that because of social media and the ability to impact so many people at one time that we are able to get more allies, such as the LGB community, as well as straight alliances, to support us, as we see with the recent anti-transgender bills and how major, you know, corporations are coming together in support of the trans community as well.
And Kroger's really jumped in on that too. At one of their new stores in the South, I don't know if you've heard about this sign they've placed. It says, "We have a unisex bathroom." And again, this is Kroger. "We have a unisex bathroom because sometimes gender-specific toilets put others into uncomfortable situations. Mm-hmm. And since we have a lot of our friends coming to see us, and we want to provide a place for our friends who are dads with daughters, moms with sons, parents with disabled children, those in the LGBTQ mm-hmm. community, adults with aging parents who may be mentally or physically disabled. Thank you for helping us to provide a safe environment for everyone."
Very awesome.
It's a really great attitude.
They're getting such flack for that.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Because they're providing a bathroom.
I think they also, like their insurance coverage now mm-hmm. also covers transgendered individuals or people considering going through transition.
Do you know helping me overcome their open carryness?
Mm-hmm. It is. Right. Do you know, I forgot where it was, but somebody said in a group, "Have you ever heard of anything like same or a bathroom that everybody uses?" And I said, "Yeah, I grew up in a house where we had one of those."
Absolutely.
You know, it's not that hard.
It's not a hard concept.
I bet in your house, Lerone, you and Gabrielle share the same bathroom.
But Lerone gets way less time.
All right, exactly.
There's like tiny windows where you can dash in and dash out.
Right, exactly. You know, I was just going to ask, you know, last year the city of Houston suffered a really crushing defeat mm-hmm. With their attempt to have a non-discrimination bill that covered everybody. The HERO bill was defeated. You know, and leading up to that, I remember seeing a video of somebody from our own community that was championing the passage of the bill in favor for it. Not in favor for it. They thought that transgender individuals should not be able to go mm-hmm. to their chosen bathroom, and it was mm-hmm. a lesbian woman.
Mm-hmm.
I was just disgusted to see her on camera.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's
but
terrible.
Yeah, it was. It was, and she was going on and on and on about it. But anyway, so I just thought, you know, so I think there's always been like there's this divide between the T right. community right. and the LG community. Do right. you think that's getting better? Is there more understanding, more cohesiveness, or is the Y getting bigger?
I would say that it's getting better. But I would say a lot of that is that the LGB community is having to be educated by the masses versus taking the time to really sit down with us as transgender people, even though we're saying, "Hey, we're here, we're part of the community," and they're saying, "No, you're not, you're too weird, you know, at least we got our foot in the door, we don't want you setting us right. back, you know."
And Carter, you said, no, that's Espy. Espy is Carter's wife.
But I will say that it's getting more progressive, because even as a community organizer, there are a lot more lesbian and gay organizations that are showing support for the trans organizations and trans groups that are collaborating on community events in order to bring our youth together, have parental support for lesbian and trans kids and gay kids.
Do you know what? It's getting to the point where there is no gay group around, no legitimate gay group around mm-hmm. that doesn't have a board member who's trans,
mm-hmm.
volunteers who are trans. Right. I mean, every group mm-hmm. does. Mm-hmm.
Just about, yeah, definitely.
If they know it or if they don't.
Right, I like it.
Well, okay. Do you know, we did a swimsuit edition at Dallas Voice a couple of years ago, and one of the complaints was, well, there's nobody trans in there, and you know what? Yes, there was, and they just didn't.
You just didn't know.
Recognize her. So, yeah.
Very awesome.
Yeah.
Very awesome.
Surprise.
Uh-huh, surprise.
I'll be in the next edition when you're looking for a trans guy.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We are almost out of time. Carter is the president.
Yes, I am the founder and executive director of Black Trans Men,
Inc. Executive director of Black Trans Advocacy, which includes Black Trans Men, Black Trans Women, a national organization that is based here in Dallas. They have a conference coming up on
April 25th through May the 1st, and everyone is welcome. You don't have to be black. You don't have to be trans. If you believe in equality, come out, have fun, get empowered, and get information.
And I went to a couple of your sessions last year. They were fascinating. They were really well done.
So we should probably set up a table and start organizing ourselves to be freedom peers. Get our buses and let's go through the South and pee.
So come out to the conference and sign up with Patti.
The restroom, so. And then you might be taking up some mirror time. So.
That's a good point. We'll have to plan around that.
We'll have to schedule in the mirror time. The lesbians over here are not used to that.
I'll give up my mirror time.
We're out of time. Thank you all.
Thank you all very much.
Thanks so much for having us.
And we'll be back next week with more Lambda Weekly.
Thanks, y'all. Great show.
KNON 89.3 FM in Dallas and Fort Worth, the voice of the people. Business owners, tell KNON's listeners about your business. You can put your business or event on KNON. KNON currently has space available to run announcements for you. Tell KNON's listeners about your goods, services, nightclub, concert, or event. Help keep the voice of the people on the air while putting your information on the air. KNON's been named the number one radio station in Dallas by both the Dallas Observer and D Magazine. Put your business with Dallas's number one station. Call now for more information at 214-828-9500, extension 227, or extension 233. For more information, go to KNON.org and click on the Run Spots on KNON page. It's a great way for your business to support community radio while letting more people know about you.